Hello, welcome to another episode of Gospel Gal. I am Marissa Namir, Gospel Gal. In today's episode, Joy and I will be discussing Chapter 2 from the great book Sacred Bond by Brown and Keel, The Covenant of Works.
I think it's good to be busy. I'd much rather be busy than bored, because I've been there too, and bored is not good. Bored is when you get time to ruminate on things that bother you, and so I like to be busy and active in my life and my vocation. I don't know about you.
I do like to be busy. I think sometimes they overdo it, though.
Yeah, too busy is stressful.
Yes.
So today we're going to talk about the covenant of works.
Ooh.
We're reading from the great book Sacred Bond by Brown and Keel. We strongly recommend this book. We already have one episode or a couple of episodes on this book. We've done the introduction and then chapter one. So today we're going to talk about the covenant of works is chapter two. And Joy, do you know how to define the covenant of works? I'll put you on the spot.
Oh, nice. Thanks. The covenant of works is defined as God's commitment to give Adam and his posterity in him eternal life for obedience or eternal death for disobedience. So it's basically the covenant that God made with Adam and all of the human race, because Adam is the representative of the human race, that he would grant Adam and the entire human race eternal life on the condition that Adam obeys perfectly and perpetually. So that is basically how I would define the covenant of works. Marissa, did you want to add anything else?
Yeah, I do. I think that this, and the authors of the chapter don't really go into this at all, but it's important that we understand and affirm the covenant of works. There are leaders in the evangelical Calvinistic community, actually in Reformed churches, as well as quasi-Reformed Calvinistic Baptist churches, that absolutely deny the covenant of works. And when that happens, you know, we'll go into why it is important for us to understand and affirm the covenant of works. But when it is denied, it causes all kinds of problems and confusion for the body of Christ as we consider our own lives and the way we navigate ourselves in sanctification.
And I really like the highlight or italicized sentences where it talks a little bit about the different aspects of the covenant of works. So the first one says, first, God is the one who made the covenant, and he did so at creation. So he said, for Adam and Eve to be made in the image of God is for them to be in covenant with God. At creation, God commits himself to his creation to sustain them and be God to them. So also being created in the image of God by necessity obligates Adam to God. In Genesis 1:26, God fashions male and female in his image so that they may have dominion, which is an obligation. God's act of creation generates a relationship with implicit obligations, namely to imitate God. God's covenantal commitment to his human creation then is evident in Genesis 1, even before the narrower command not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. This prohibition focuses the covenant relation on a specific test, but the covenant is bigger than this one command. I thought that was actually a really good point there, because we only consider that covenant to be specific to his command not to eat of the fruit of the tree. But it also includes perfectly imitating God's character as being image bearers of God. And then I like the second point he made, which he said, the promise of life everlasting is based on Adam's obedience. I think that's a good point because it sets up by contrast what actually Jesus accomplished as being the second Adam.
Yeah, good stuff. And we'll get into that second Adam concept later. I think it's important to attack this word covenant because this is a problem for some in the evangelical community as well. They make the assumption that there was not a covenant in the beginning. One of the key passages that I will usually go to when I'm thinking about covenant and the covenantal works specifically, some people call this the covenant with Adam or the Adamic covenant. We call it the covenant of works because it's very works oriented. And this is why we are wired towards works from the beginning and why it's hard for us, even after we're saved sometimes, to put away the thought that our own works are going to somehow contribute towards our righteousness or earn it. There is evidence that the authors go over to show that this is a covenant. And this is on, I think it's page 52. Hosea 6 verse 7, this passage reflects the covenant with Adam by saying, "But like Adam, they transgressed the covenant. There they dealt faithlessly with me." The prophet here is actually making a play off of the word Adam. He is pointing to the two entities named Adam. First, the man Adam and a town named Adam. Both references characterize the severe nature of Israel's sin. Hosea's allusion to the person of Adam suggests a parallel situation. Like Israel, Adam broke the Lord's covenant by failing to obey, and he suffered the curses of the covenant. This relationship with Adam from the beginning was a covenant of works.
They mentioned another passage in scripture, Isaiah 24:5. And it says, "All this evidence from Genesis 2 to 3, however, does not stand alone. Several other passages in God's holy word support the covenantal nature of Genesis 2 through 3. First, there's Isaiah 24:5. And here God is denouncing in judgment the inhabitants of the earth for having transgressed the law and statutes. They broke the everlasting covenant. The laws in view in this passage are creational, and all humanity remains under them. And the result of mankind's unrighteousness is that the earth mourns and withers." So they referred back to that. And there's also a lot of verses in, I think, Romans 5:12-19, too, that suggests a covenant of works.
I think it's on page 53.
It's also referring to Romans 5:12-19 and 1 Corinthians 15:21-22. And then the book goes on to say, in both of these passages, the Apostle Paul compares Adam and Christ as a matching pair. The Apostle's point about Christ in Romans 5:19-21 and 1 Corinthians 15:21-22 is dependent on the similarities he draws between Adam and Christ. Without a doubt, Paul highlights differences between them, which are also drastically crucial, but the differences are meaningless without the more baseline similarities. And he's talking about that, the idea of Adam disobeying and Christ obeying. So I, again, like this part because I think it's really good with contextualizing, especially in the New Testament scripture, when they do make those comparisons between Adam and Christ. Like you know that both of them were under a covenant of works. Please correct me if I'm wrong, but you can see that Adam failed, but Christ succeeded. And you can see, I don't know, I feel like it's just a better way of framing things, and it gives the gospel a lot more clarity when it's contrasted between the failure of Adam and then the success of Christ.
Amen. Yes, it's crystal clear to me, and I never really understood this or noticed it as I was growing up in the church. It's not just Romans where it makes this comparison between Adam and Christ, but also there is a line drawn from Israel to Christ. And in the Old Testament, Israel is sometimes referred to as my son. We know there was a man named Israel or Jacob, right? So there's a line drawn from Israel to Christ also. They're both called my son, my son. And when Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, God makes an allusion to this, and he calls Christ my son, only in this time Israel transgressed God's law. Christ is called my son, and the Lord said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. So there's a line drawn there too, and in that we will see that Christ is fulfilling this covenant of works on behalf of God's people. Where Israel failed, Christ succeeds.
I did have a question about, because I'm not too familiar with the types of controversies that arise from questioning the covenant of works. Like, I kind of think, like, to me, I feel like it's pretty obvious. But what are some of the things that you've come across, either explicitly or implicitly denied the covenant of works?
What reasons have you heard for the denial?
You know, I've only actually learned about covenant theology within the context of my church, so I'm not familiar with like some of the other oppositions that are out there that would deny the covenant of works. I'm just curious as to like why. To me, I guess it just seems pretty obvious that it's there and we should believe it, but I'm not sure why somebody wouldn't.
Well, one of the things that it does, I'm not sure why they deny it either. I don't know how it's beneficial to deny the covenant of works. So I don't even know if I can answer your question very well on that. But I know that what happens if you do deny it is, I think I made allusion to this earlier, but when you deny the covenant of works, basically there's no foundation or background to understand that Christ is actually fulfilling the covenant of works on our behalf. And that presents a huge problem, where justification has to do with receiving forgiveness of sins. But as far as the imputation of righteousness, there's a void there. And there are some that even deny the imputation of righteousness. But we are imputed with righteousness because Christ kept every jot and tittle of the law on our behalf. So it's an incomplete salvation if we deny the covenant of works, the imputation of righteousness as a logical conclusion of Christ actually fulfilling it for us. And then your sanctification also, it's like you get to the end of your life. If Christ hasn't fulfilled all righteousness, if Christ hasn't fulfilled the covenant of works for us, then we're in a position we actually end up using our sanctification as a measuring stick of our salvation, as if we have something then to show forth to God to say, here's my works, so let me into heaven on this basis.
I agree. I think understanding this really helps contextualize the law-gospel distinction too, and why it's so important. Because I can tell you from my own personal experience, using my sanctification level as a measuring stick is not fun. Produces a lot of anxiety.
It would. It would either produce in us anxiety, fear, dread, or pride and hubris, as we think we actually attained what God has for us to do. I think it's kind of frightening when you hear leaders in the church say, I'm a Christian because I love God. That's our very problem. Even in our sanctified state, we don't fulfill the law perfectly. So we have to have a Savior who provides that. We are seen as obedient because we are in Christ. His righteousness has been imputed and applied to us. And therefore, we're just seen as if we have never sinned and as if we had perfectly obeyed, as if we had completed and fulfilled the covenant of works ourselves.
I guess segue into the last part of the book. I like the questions at the bottom. Why do you think the covenant of works is important for the Christian life?
I actually was going to read from page 54. And this, I think, is direct to that question as well as answer some other ones. But it says on page 54, what are some of the ramifications, or why is this doctrine important? For one, Adam's failure and the covenant of works directly impacts our present condition. His fall brought death to all men and resulted in creation being cursed. Because Adam sinned, his guilt was imputed, and we inherited his corrupt nature. the broken nature of the covenant of works demonstrates that we cannot keep God's law and earn a life everlasting. In Adam's fall, we died. Sin came to all, and with sin its curse, namely death. Additionally, the covenant of works reveals the standard of God's justice. In the garden, God assigned the price of everlasting life with him as perfect obedience to his law. After the fall, this does not change. God's law did not change, and neither did his requirement for life. The covenant of works reveals that heaven must be earned. God's justice means he cannot merely give away eternal life. Life must be earned by perfect righteousness according to the law. Finally, the covenant of works with the first Adam sheds light on the work of the last Adam. To deny or redefine the covenant of works is to do the same to the work of Christ. Christ comes as the last Adam, our representative. What he earns comes to us. Where Adam failed to earn life for his descendants, Christ succeeds by fulfilling all righteousness and so meriting heaven for himself and his people. Heaven must be earned before it can be given as a gift. Christ earned heaven and then gives it to us as a free gift through faith. That, my friend, is good news.
Great news. To bring this home, I think of a song called Embracing Accusation by Shane and Shane. And I think about the fact that Adam's failure constantly accuses us. It accuses us even as Christians. And now, because of the covenant of works, and also because Christ fulfilled the covenant of works for us and in our place, we can embrace that accusation and say, yeah, I failed. I can't keep the law perfectly. I'm not perfect. And I am deserving of God's judgment because of that. But God, but Jesus, he succeeded where I failed. He merited for me what I couldn't earn myself. And now I have everything that he has earned as mine. I can call it and say that it's mine by faith. And I can embrace accusation and safety because Jesus is safe for me. That is something that every Christian has as their one hope in life and in death. You know, Heidelberg 1, what is your only hope in life and in death? That I am not my own, but belong with body and soul to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. And the covenant works really highlights by contrast how faithful Jesus is for us.
Yes, thanks be to God. We have a great mediator in the person of Jesus Christ, and he has paid in full all that is required for our relationship with him. So yeah, I love the point that you made that every believer has this as our constant hope, that every good work that was required of us has been fulfilled by Jesus Christ himself. There is no debt. And even the good works that we do here on earth, although those works are tainted with our sinful corruption, we have this hope that those works that we do are not meritorious. Everything that we do from justification forward is just extra blessing that he provides for us so that we can be a blessing to our neighbors.
Yeah, I'm just saying, if there is one aspect about the gospel that brings me the most comfort and allows me, gets me really excited or fills my eyes with tears, is that doctrine of justification and the imputed righteousness of Christ. Because I can tell you, shame and guilt are things that I struggle with presently, even today. And just hearing that Jesus obeyed the law for me and in my place, there are no words to describe how that feels. To be known and loved by God like that, and knowing that he sees and knows me intimately, knows all of my sin, knows my imperfections, knows all the thoughts that I think that I would never want anybody else to know about, the highest judge in the universe has become my father because of what Christ has done and has merited for me in my place. And I will gladly trust him by faith alone.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
Thank you for joining us for another episode of Gospel Gal. We hope that this segment on the covenant of works has been a blessing to you, that you are looking to Christ as your second Adam, who provided in full and completed the covenant of works on your behalf. Please be sure to join us again for our next episode. Until then, please be sure to like, subscribe, and share our social media content, our YouTube content, our website podcast content. We are hoping that many, many people will be blessed as a result and take comfort in the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Thanks again for joining. Gospel blessings.